about to get started here. So when Richard invited me to speak, I wanted to do something different. I normally talk about real estate, green buildings, all this kind of stuff. But I really thought today he wanted to inspire a lot of the young people and maybe not so old people in the room. So I thought I would talk about being happy at work. So I know it's after lunch, you're kind of sleepy, but can I just ask you all here, who is happy doing what you're doing? Who's happy at work? Can I see? Or are your bosses just beside you? So you can't give a different answer. That's pretty good. Half the room, people say you're happy at work. I'm going to talk today about the decisions I've made in my life and what I've done in order to find happiness and fulfillment in my career, in my job. And hopefully, at the end of this talk, maybe I'm going to show a video in a bit. You'll all end up as happy as this guy in this video. Please watch this. It might seem crazy what I'm about to say. EJ Hernandez, he works at Film Life, who's our anchor tenant in Net Lima. So one of the things we've done at the Net Group is we really want to talk about this hashtag TNG Happy at Work campaign. So last year, can I have the slides back on, please? We started this competition and we asked our tenants, we have about 25,000 people working in our buildings, to all give in their videos and photos about them being happy at work. And he was our grand prize winner. So he actually won a GoPro Hero camera as part of that competition. And another group actually got an all-expense-paid vacation to Baler as their prize for doing a video. So why happy at work? You know, we've been in real estate. I'm a third-generation real estate developer. We've been doing this a long time. We've done lots of different projects. And we realized over time and across different projects that ultimately we can do a good job in quality, we can do a good job in finishing, we can be a green building, we can be efficient. But really, the best indicator of success for a real estate developer is if the people coming to our buildings are happy. If the employees are happy working in our buildings, then mission accomplished for us. So that's really our focus now, is really focusing on how we can create a good experience for all of our tenants and make sure they are happy at work. And we're all faced with, you know, different choices in our lives. And I think everybody agrees that you want to be happy, healthy, wealthy. But I'm sure all of you know this doesn't happen overnight. It doesn't fall on your lap. You don't become healthy, wealthy, or happy just like that. It takes conscious decision-making. It takes conscious choices. So today, I'm going to share with you three conscious choices I've made in my life in order to be fulfilled and to be happy at what I do. Okay? So we'll go to the first one. Choose to be proud. So people would always ask me, Raymond, you know, you're in a real estate family business. You were destined to be in real estate. You didn't have much of a choice. That was your forced option. Actually, not true. My dad gave me every opportunity to do whatever I wanted, but I found that I really want to work in real estate. And the reason for that is I get a lot of fulfillment in doing real estate because at the end of the day, I look at the buildings that we develop and I know they're going to be around for a long time and I say, wow, I really feel that I contributed. I really have a strong contribution. I may pass, but the buildings will be here for the next generation and hopefully generations after that. So really, for me, it was about having pride in my work, being proud of what I was doing, and knowing that there was a legacy I was leaving behind. Because Winston Churchill famously said, we shape our buildings thereafter they shape us. And the buildings will be here a long time. So there's a lot of fulfillment that I get out of that. And I guess my point here is for you to ask yourselves, do you have pride in what you do? Do you work with a company that you are proud of? Do you work for a boss that you are proud of? Are you proud of your product or service? Because if not, then you have to ask yourself, am I doing the right thing? Am I at the right company? Am I at the right job? Am I at the right industry? Because if you're not proud of what you're doing, chances are the likelihood you'll be very fulfilled at what you're doing is also not very good. Okay? Just a bit of background. These are the 7 buildings we've developed in the Bonifacio Global City. We started in the late 90s with the first building and finished that in 2002 with Net One. And currently, we're finishing Net Park, which is our 7th building. We're going to complete that maybe in the next 2 months. And aside from being proud of what you're doing, it's also about having pride with who you work with. So here's a picture of me with my father, Charlie, and Jack Dupaski, the 2 founders of the Net Group. Very entrepreneurial, very visionary leaders. Tina Samson's on the other end. I work with her. She's our corporate counsel and manages our day-to-day. And together, we really have a great working relationship. I'm very proud to work with them. They've really mentored me. I've learned so much working with them. And so that relationship is also very important. Are you proud of the people you work with? And if you're a boss, ask yourself, are your employees or teammates proud to work with you? Or are they saying, wow, I have a horrible boss. I can't stand to leave, you know, this company because I can't take him, you know? These are things you have to think about because, you know, people say pride is not a good thing, but there are situations where having pride can be very positive, and that's what I'm talking about today. Are you proud of your office mates? This is not everyone, but a small sample of our TNG family, and I really am very proud of them, each one of them, whether it's a junior accountant, our senior finance person, the building managers, down the line. We're a very small group, but I'm very, very proud of the amount of work and dedication each one of them brings, and I hope they're also as proud to work with each other and work with us. Because really, the Filipino is world-class. So here we went to Kuala Lumpur. We received an award for Net Park, which is the best high-rise commercial development in the Philippines for last year, given by the International Property Awards. Because I believe if you work with people you are proud of, and you work for a company you are proud of, and you're doing something you are proud in, chances are people will recognize that because you will probably achieve excellence. Okay, choice number 2, lead and make a difference. Here's a question I'd like to ask all of you. Will you leave your children a planet Earth that is healthier and safer than the planet Earth your parents left you? So my father's not here yet, but I would have ribbed in them this because I think the earlier generation, the past generations have really screwed up our planet. Most of us here know this, right? We see it every day in the media. Planet Earth is suffering, and that is really the fault of previous generations. So I think there is a responsibility on our end, on our generation, to do something about this. Because the Philippines is vulnerable. You saw this in Typhoon Yolanda. You have a storm which people thought was not possible. A storm that was so strong that the wind meters meant to measure speed were breaking because it was beyond design capacity. A storm so big it was almost as big as the entire country. And this is not going to get any better. We're going to see more of these catastrophic events happening to us, not only our country, but around the world. But what's scary about us, particularly here, this is a report done by Grosvenor, which is a real estate group out of the UK, and they ranked cities. I'm sorry, it's very small and you probably can't read this, but the chart on the left shows cities from least vulnerable to most vulnerable. So least vulnerable on top, you have Vancouver, Calgary, and who's fourth from the bottom? Manila. We are the 4th most vulnerable city in this study. But what the study says is vulnerability as your reality, right? Sometimes you can't do much about it. It's because of your location, it's because of your climate, all of these different things. But the chart on the right shows how each city adapts to that vulnerability. With your institutions, your systems, and everything that you have, if something bad happens, can you respond? Can you adapt? And the most adaptive city, for example, at the top is New York City. And where are we? 2nd from the bottom again. So not only are we one of the most vulnerable cities, we are also one of the least adaptive. That's a double negative that is very, very bad for us. It's really a wake-up call that we can no longer continue the way we do things. We have to make a difference. We have to make a change. So when I came back from the U.S., I took my master's in real estate in the U.S., and I came back, and my father too asked me, Raymond, what did you learn? And I said, you really want to bring back that idea about green buildings and sustainability. And we were doing real estate at that time, and there was nothing much in terms of green building and sustainability at that time. So I said, you know, I really want to push this. Lucky for me, I met up with some like-minded people, and we founded and incorporated the Philippine Green Building Council. We are turning 9 years today. We have over 300 corporations. You can read the figures up there, I won't go through in detail. But really, what we've been doing over the past 9 years is really trying to push forward the idea that green buildings are important, they're necessary, and we need to change the way we develop and do our business so that we are more sustainable about the impacts we're making on the environment. Together with 100 national green building councils around the world, the Philippine Green Building Council is really leading the charge globally in trying to change the real estate industries. So we really want to see a shift from what we call gray to green. Last year, I was in Hong Kong. This is for the World Green Building Council. Here's a class photo. So I met people from Africa, Europe, US, Europe, all over the world. People came together, and it's such a powerful experience because, you know, sometimes here in the Philippines, I get frustrated. Sometimes you talk to people, even my fellow developers, and they don't get it. They tell me, ah, Raymond, who wants to go green? I have a budget, I have a timetable, I have so much work, my staff is stretched. I mean, I can't even think about doing things differently. And yet when I'm with these kinds of people abroad, I really realize that globally, there is a growing momentum and people are saying, there's no choice, we have to change, we have to do something about the way we're doing our development. I like this slide a lot because one of the things about taking a leadership role and trying to make a difference is sometimes it's not easy. So to give you a bit of a story, when we first started the council, our very first event, we had 80 people confirmed. Guess how many people showed up for the event? Any guesses? 7 people. Of the 7 people, 3 were staff, 2 were speakers, and 2 were guests. I was one of the speakers, and my dad was one of the guests. And my dad whispered to me after that, he said, you know, Raymond, maybe the industry's not ready. Maybe this whole green building, it's really nice and I'm going to support you and I'm going to be there for you, but maybe we're not ready. Maybe the Philippine real estate industry just doesn't care. And I said, no, we have to do something about this. We have to change. I said, even if it was a setback, even if it was a slap in the face, I said, we need to still push on. So this is a picture last year of our Building Green conference, which we had in MOA. And what I like about this is, these are all of the speakers we had for that conference. And we didn't even have a big enough photo wall for all of the speakers. We had over 200 people attend this conference. And really, the momentum toward green building is there. In the middle, you see Secretary Acosta of the LLDA, Laguna Lake Development Authority. Next to him, Secretary Siring of the Climate Change Commission. We had speakers from the World Green Building Council. We had speakers from our other Asian neighbors talking about green projects they're doing in the region. And on the other side, you have even local governments. You have Raquel there from the city of Pasig talking about how they can do green building codes across municipalities. So the conversation has moved. The momentum is building. And it's really very exciting for me that after 9 years of hard work, we're really starting to see some movement in our market. But a lot of work still left to be done. Here we have awarding Secretary Acosta. So you may not know this, but the Laguna Lake Development Authority building has been awarded 2-star BERDE certification for that building as of design. If you have not been to that building, I suggest you take a look. It's the first green government building. And most people say, the Philippine government can't do a lot of things right. Well, here is an example of the Philippine government doing something right. It's a beautiful building, done on budget, and is one of a fantastic example of how you can do a green building without, you know, spending extreme amounts of money or capital. And of course, going back to our business as developers, I wouldn't feel right if I didn't walk the talk. You know, if I'm sitting in the council and trying to push green building, if we did do something as a developer, it would be very embarrassing. So we've made a lot of commitments in terms of growing green and becoming sustainable. So Net Lima, our one of our projects, is the pilot project for BERD. We were awarded 4 stars. That's a picture of us receiving our 4-star green building certification. Net Park, which we're finishing soon, is our 7th office building. We're going for 5 stars, the highest possible rating under BERD, which is our local green building rating system. We're also planning to be the first net zero building for water. So what that means is during the rainy season, we want to capture enough water from our aircon and water harvesting systems so we don't need to draw water from the utility. So Paul, I'm sorry, he spoke earlier, Subic Water. So I don't have anything against the utilities, but if I can reduce the amount of water I can pull from the utilities and generate that on-site and not have to throw away so much water into the wastewater system, that's really something we want to do. So cross your fingers, we haven't hit our first rainy season, so I do want to see if all of the studies will pan out, that we can actually produce enough water on-site for all of the requirements of the building. And then for Net 1 to Plaza, which are older buildings, we're currently undergoing certification for BERDE, which is for operations. And within this year, we want to be the first developer in the Philippines to have its entire portfolio certified as green buildings. Something that I would have thought the public developer companies would have done a long time ago. But it really takes sometimes private leadership to kind of push the envelope and try to get this moving forward. Another organization I'm also part of is EO, Entrepreneurs Organization. I don't know how many here are entrepreneurs. If you are, you may want to look up this organization. It is the largest global organization for entrepreneurship. I joined 6 years ago, and it's really been a fantastic experience. EO, for me, has been one of the great opportunities for me to grow. And what's interesting about my EO experience is that as a member, I didn't want to raise my hand and do anything. I was always called upon to serve. Raymond, can you take a leadership role? Can you step up? And I'm busy. I have so many things I'm doing. But they were very persistent, and they would always push me. So I eventually said yes. So I served on the board. I eventually became president of the local chapter. This is me with my fellow presidents from Southeast Asia in Bali, where we had our own planning session for entrepreneur organization chapters all around the world. And these are my fellow presidents from the Southeast Asia region. The year after, I joined the global board, and I became the regional director for a student entrepreneur competition called GSEA, the Global Student Entrepreneur Competition for Students. We give out awards for the best global student entrepreneur every year. And so this was in Athens, Greece, where we had our big planning session. Again, I was called upon to do this, and I was very hesitant. But I noticed when I said yes, and I'm sure many of you will experience that, you will be called upon for leadership at some point in your lives. Say yes, take that risk, because it's such an opportunity to grow and to also give back. And this is me as regional director for GSEA. I went with 9 students from Asia. It was the best ever performance of Asia at the Global Awards. Of the 9, 2 made it to the last final 6, which was very impressive because no Asian had made it to the final round of 6 ever before. Last year, we had 2. Just as a sign of the commitment of how entrepreneurship is growing in our region. And hopefully, this year, we'll also have a great showing from Asia. So again, here it's trying to inspire entrepreneurship. So I talked about green building sustainability, but entrepreneurship is also something very close to my heart. And again, taking a leadership role and trying to make that difference can really improve your fulfillment in what you do. Okay, last, almost there. My last conscious choice was to push the envelope. Because once you get stuck doing the same thing over and over, there's really no improvement. You'll get bored. And sometimes we all need that challenge in order for us to contribute and make a difference. So when we did Net Lima and Park, we went back to the drawing board and said, we could have developed the buildings. We had a cookie cutter approach already. We could have kept doing that. Probably would have been the most economic and the easiest way to do it. But we said, no, it was time to do a new generation of building for BGC, where we had to again try to push what was being done locally and try to see if we can do better than what people were doing. So the first step with our architects, and we work with Chad Oppenheim out of Miami, he said, we're in a tropical country. Let's take a look at the sun patterns, because the sun will dictate a lot of the design for the building, because here you're always in the light of the sun. So we looked at the sun patterns, and he basically came up with this design approach where he said, why don't we have a glass building so a lot of natural light comes in from the sun and people have nice views, but let's wrap the building with an aluminum sunshade so that you can shade the heat from glare and from heat throughout the day. And then let's make that functional piece of architecture also something nice, something attractive, something that would make the building stand out, give it sort of an iconic kind of feel. And so because we went with that, we said, look, let's have this beautiful yet functional architecture as the signature green element of these buildings. We basically came out with this, which is Net Lima. I hope many of you have seen this. If not, when you're at BGC, you can drive by. So our anchor tenants here are Philam Life and Coca-Cola. So this was a very successful building for us because it was the first building we designed and built as green from the very start. It was the first building, first time for us to make that effort. And you know, the sunshades worked out really well. A lot of our tenants saved power. Deloitte, for example, one of our accounting tenants, they have their headquarters in Net Lima. Compared to their older buildings when they moved here, they saved about 40% on their power bill compared to their previous building by being in this building. So it was something for us which we are very proud of. Here's some night shots of the building. And this is what Net Lima, Net Park, and Ascot will look like when it's done. So Net Lima's on the far left, Net Park, which we're finishing in the next 2 months, is in the middle. And then you have the Ascot Hotel, which is already completed and operational on the far right. That's a render. This is what it looks like today. I took this picture last Monday, so it's a very fresh picture. Apologies, it's not a very clear picture, but we're almost there. So you can start to see those sunshades wrapping around the building. And really, people think it's just to make the building look cool, but it's not. It really has a very functional element to that design. This is a public park at the foot of Net Park. And this is the typical park you would see in BGC. So one of the things that we were also trying to do with this project, we said, can we also give back to our community? Because most buildings are designed so that your experience starts from the time you enter the front door, but they don't really give much regard to the public realm where the building sits. So we said, look at this public park. It looks okay, not really so bad, it's just green with some trees, but really nothing special, nothing really good for the community. So what we did was we worked with Bonifacio and we're doing a pioneer project which is called the Adopt a Park Program. We partnered with Fort Bonifacio Development Corp and said, look, you may not have the budget to develop this park, but what if we fund the design and development of the park and we jointly manage it as a public space, public community piece? They agreed, and so this park will also be called Net Park. It was designed by Jeffrey, who is a world-class public landscape architect and public artist. And what you see there in the back is going to be called the Selfie Sculpture. It's a 9 meter tall steel sculpture. You can see the people, you can see how big that piece is going to be, right? So, you know, you might say, oh, looks cool, it's a steel structure, might be interesting. But here's what we're going to do with that. It's called Selfie because we're going to project the faces of people onto this sculpture. And what's going to happen is, if you come to BGC in the future, you're going to be able to get an app, go to this spot, take a selfie of yourself, your picture will come out on that sculpture, and you can take a selfie of your selfie with that sculpture, right? So the idea here, thank you. So the idea here is, you have a lot of cities where they have that postcard shot, right? Where you say, if I'm going to Paris, I have that Eiffel Tower shot. If I'm going to New York, I have that Statue of Liberty shot. Most cities have that, but BGC does not have that shot. That shot where you're like, if you're a foreign visitor, if you're coming to the city, that's the shot you got to have, right? And it's the only place in the world where you can probably say, my shot is uniquely me because it's my face that's going to be in the background, right? This is also very interesting because it's very Filipino. We are the selfie capital of the world. And that's what Jeffrey wanted to capitalize on. He says, how do we create public art that changes over time, that's not just static? It's dynamic, so people want to come back. It wants to attract people to the neighborhood. You got to have it always changing. And how do you make it changing and engaging and interactive? Well, nothing beats putting people's faces up there, right? So there are a lot of technology issues, I will admit. We're still trying to look for the right partners. So we might do LED, we might do projection, we need to work with you know, an app developer or some other group to kind of figure out how we're going to do this. But the sculpture itself is already in final design. It's going to be fabricated in the U.S., shipped over here in bended portions and assembled here. So our hope is maybe within the next 6 months, you'll all be able to come over and take your selfie picture with the selfie sculpture. So again, trying to push the envelope in terms of what you can do. So we could have just left it this, right? But that would have been the cheapest. I mean, we're not making any money from this public space. We're not, in fact, it's costing us a fortune to do this. And yet, if people don't take that effort, if you don't make that community gesture, we are not able to create a better environment for everyone. So from that, we're going to go to this. And then this is what's going to look like when it's not lit up with the face. You'll have the stock exchange in the background and then the high street on the upper right-hand side. So again, how else do we push the envelope? Here we are, when open access became a reality, we were the first developer to commit that an entire portfolio is going to be powered through renewable energy. So we have a purchase power contract called Aboitiz Power. 100% of our building's power comes from the geothermal power plant in Macban. And we actually visited that power plant. It was very impressive. The Philippines has a lot of renewable energy coming into the pipeline. And as consumers and as businesses, you today have the power to actually dictate and choose who your supplier of power is. So I know many of you may not be in a position to do something, but just take note, if you can choose an office or if you can choose a supplier in the future, ask them, do they have renewable? Can I power renewably? And maybe we can start to see more and more of our buildings transfer from the dirty coal power that we have to the more renewable sources, whether it's wind, solar, or geothermal. Another interesting thing we did was we introduced the first electric car charger in Net Lima. So that's not my Tesla. I wish it was. That was lent to us by MVP for this launch. Why did we put an electric car charger in Net Lima? Again, there's no economic benefit. How many here drive electric cars? None, right? How many of you plan to buy an electric car in the next year? Probably none. That's the problem. See, the reason we don't have electric cars is because we don't have the infrastructure to enable electric car users to plug their vehicles, right? If you're worried your car's going to stop on you anywhere in the road and you can't reload it with electricity, then you're not going to buy the cars. If consumers don't want to buy the cars, the manufacturers should not bring the cars in, right? So what we want to do here is we want to start privately led initiative to provide the infrastructure for electric car charging so that, similar to other countries, it now becomes realistic for the suppliers, distributors, and the market to actually start purchasing and distributing electric cars. Right now, the only electric cars are public utility vehicles. We don't have too many private electric cars. Unfortunately, this is hardly used, because there aren't electric cars, but for us it was a proof of concept. We want to get the message out there that we believe in electric vehicles, that this is something good for the environment, and that we all have to take our own steps to try to introduce the facilities to make this a reality. So, just wrap up to recap, what are the three choices I've made in my life to find happiness and fulfillment in my work? First, choose to be proud. Next, choose to lead and make a difference. And last, choose to push the envelope. I'd like to show a quick video, if you indulge me, of Net Park right before I end this talk. So I have a video of the building coming up, and I hope you enjoy it.
Cause you're a sky, cause you're a sky full of stars. In the sky, 'cause in
I have a party message for all of you. Just have that last slide up. So always remember, it's not work if you love what you do and you work with people you love. Thank you very much.